center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters.
Let's go!
Presenting the world's only business school without the BS with optometrist and entrepreneur Dr. Robert Zoellner and the former Small Business Administration Entrepreneur of the Year in your ear, Clay Clark. It's the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170. 3, 2, 1.
Boom, 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 and boom. Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark, the former USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, sent here on a mission to get you into a great financial position. Well, what does it mean to be in a great financial position? What does that mean? Well, this is what it means to me. It means that you could go to Atwood's on a Saturday and buy whatever the heck you want and not have to stress out about it. It's the ability to, my daughter goes to St. Augustine School, and it's the ability to, buy a hot dog if you want to, at the performance. Yep. It's the ability to take the kids to Chick-fil-A. It's the ability to live in a way where finances are not something that you think about. But what happens is by default, if you're not intentional, you're going to drift and find yourself working at either a job you don't like or running a business you don't like. Because according to Forbes, 57% of people want to start a business. They want to do it. But 8 out of 10 of the people who do start a business fail. And so every single day on this show, we like to break down business school without the BS. We want to teach you specifically what you need to do. And today's show goes out to all the people out there who want to learn how to fund their startup business or how to fund their business growth. You've got a business idea, or maybe you have an existing business, but you want to know how to fund it. And I'm not going to teach you a bunch of theories. I'm not going to teach you a bunch of vague ideas. I'm going to teach you specifically the moves that will work. Okay.
Can you teach me the Pythagorean theorem?
I could. It's A squared plus B squared equals C squared.
Okay, that's the only theory we're going to go over. That's the only one.
Big shout out to Pythagoras.
What did you just square?
Whoa. Steve.
Speaking of squares, hey, Steve.
Hey. Oh, that's a good one.
All right, so love you, buddy. Move number one, credit cards. Am I kidding? No. I've met many top entrepreneurs who are very, very successful, who funded their business using no interest 18-month credit cards when they started. I'm telling you. And if you go to creditcards.com, Barclay has a card, American Express has a card. And the bottom line is a lot of people, Steve, they don't want to, and a lot of banks aren't going to lend you $24,000 to start your business. They're not going to lend you $50,000 to get started. A lot of banks don't want to lend you any money until you've proven the concept. So someone's listening to the show today, and let's say you're a contractor and you want to, maybe you do some work on the side and you want to start your own construction company. Steve, you're probably not going to be able to get a standard loan to start, and maybe the credit cards is a move.
Yeah, you know, they're not, and some people will access maybe the equity in their house, get a home equity line of credit, but if you don't have that, and even when you do have that, it's a much more difficult process than going online and applying for a credit card. If you have good credit, and you can get a credit card that has a zero interest for any period of time,
Well, now somebody might be saying, because you're a mortgage professional, your company Total Lending Concepts is doing very, very well, and you guys are growing that business. A lot of people say, well, you know, I don't want to apply for a credit card because it'll hurt my credit. I don't want to get a credit card because it'll hurt my credit.
Yeah.
Steve, break down the truth about credit cards and how they impact your credit score, and just kind of walk us through maybe on a high level, or maybe even go deep if you want to, about how credit cards impact your overall credit score.
Well, here's the truth. We talk to a lot of people that just believe that credit cards are bad.
They're bad.
It's like saying, like, maybe like guns are bad, and then people say, no, people are bad, right? Well, it's the same thing with credit cards. People use them wrong. They use them improperly. They charge them up, buy groceries, buy stuff they shouldn't be buying. They jack up the balance.
Can I give you an example of how I view a credit card?
Yeah, go ahead.
I view it like a hammer. And I don't know if you've had it. For some reason, people keep putting hammers in the conference room to screw with me. I think they're putting in hammers and mallets.
I'm everywhere.
I'm serious. I think people are buying them and bringing them to the office because they know that I'm OCD.
There has to be like a dozen.
I just feel like one of these days, Steve's going to like go to Lowe's and buy all the hammers and they'll just find it. So it's so weird when you're in a meeting and the client's like, why are you holding that mallet? I don't know.
They call it the lead hammer. It's call your leads and then you smack the mallet, remember?
Now, here's the thing about the hammer, though. A hammer could be used to, obviously hammer a nail. It could be used to pull out a nail. It could be used for something positive. You could also use a hammer to bang holes in walls. You could also use a hammer to hit somebody. You could use a hammer to, it has good uses and bad uses. It's the same thing with credit, but to feel like that you shouldn't use credit cards at all to grow a business, in my mind, in my experience, from my background, that's just false, Steve.
Yeah, and here's the thing. 30% of your credit score is derived from revolving credit. So people will, every day, they'll say, well, I don't want to get my credit pulled because I'm afraid that inquiry will impact my score. No, you paying your bills on time will impact your score. And oh, by the way, you don't have any credit cards, so you don't even have the opportunity to get 30% of your score.
Ooh, hot fire. Woo!
Yeah, it's like going to like, you're in high school and you don't take math and you wonder why you don't have a 4.0. It's like you don't even have the ability
30%
to.
30% of your score is based upon revolving credit. And if you do not have a credit card, you can't build it.
No, you can't. And here's the thing.
But I don't want to go into debt.
It also doesn't matter, Clay, how big your limit is.
Come on now.
So if someone gets a card for the first time, maybe it only has a $1,000 limit.
You're a baller.
They look at the ratio of your balance versus your available credit. So it doesn't matter if you have $30,000 in available credit, or if you have $1,000 in available credit, it's if you have a $210 balance with a $1,000 limit, you're going to have the optimum score.
Can I tell you something, Steve? That really gets me going when you talk about having an optimum score and a credit card. Can I tell you something? A story. Yeah. When I was 16 years old, I remember I got my first credit card. Like a Discover card. Still have that card, by the way. I love that card.
Oh, man.
And so I had this in my basement. I sold T-shirts, you know. And my move was I realized that the high school made logo apparel that people didn't like. It said stupid stuff like, you know, Charger Pride, you know.
Or that's whack.
It says Dassel Cocato Chargers. And I thought, no.
Not going to do that.
So what I did, without the school's consent, I made my own shirts. And the shirts, I went to the game, and the shirt would say, one of our rivals was Litchfield. You know, and the wrestler, we had a wrestling team that did well. They went to state. They were dominant. They did very well. And our coach.
Did it say bleep?
Well, our coach used to say, squeeze. He'd be on the sideline, just squeeze. And I wasn't a wrestler, but no one went to wrestling until we went to the state. You know, we go down to Minneapolis to the Metrodome, and he's there. And our team was great that year. And he's just yelling, squeeze. He's just weird, like a pig, like squeeze. And so it was like, I'm good. I need a shirt that says squeeze. So I made a Dassel Cocato shirt on the back. It said, squeeze. And then it said, and bleed. Squeeze and bleed. And then we had a guy on our team who looked just like the Russian from Rocky.
Oh, wow.
And so I put Ivan Drago's face on a shirt. And, you know, just those kind of things. I would sell those shirts. Well, I'm making a lot of money. I'm bringing in a lot of money. I bought the shirts for like $3 or $4, the Hanes shirts. And I bought a T-shirt maker from a dude who owned a video store. And I'm printing shirts. And my dad and I are pulling all-nighters, printing shirts, selling shirts. And I'm going, Dad, we got like 1,000 orders now. And I need to get like $3,000 of shirts. So my dad's like, well, you need to apply for a credit card, and I'll co-sign. So I'm like 16. My dad co-signs. We get that sweet credit card, that Discover card, and I just charge that thing. Bam, I got my shirt sent to me from Hanes. I've got those shirts. We're making the shirts. I think we sold close to 1,000 shirts, and I don't remember the actual number. I think that we cleared about $10,000 of profit that weekend.
Sick.
Wow.
And made the shirts.
Yes.
And I feel bad because my dad worked at a company called Hutchinson Technology where they made the little arms for disc readers. Some of you remember when there was floppy disks and CD-ROMs. Mm. And my dad worked the night shift. I made him work the day shift with me making T-shirts, which meant awesome. He didn't sleep.
That's
you know?
Dad life right there.
So dad, my dad has since passed away. So, Dad, I want to say thank you up there. Thank you for pulling the all-nighter and the all-dayer in a row to make that possible. But is it slave labor when you make your father work? And my dad's co-signed on that. He's like, I am highly motivated. I can't believe you just spent all of it But and then when I had enough money in the bank, then I started investing in the DJ company. And I had to buy, I always had more bookings than equipment. So I had to pre-buy the equipment before I had the shows. So I'd book the show and I'd have to buy the equipment. I had to use credit cards to do that. Without credit cards, I couldn't do it. Now, Eric Chubb, Dr. Zoellner has a notable quotable that he likes to say. Dr. Zoellner, he's typically on the show with us each day, but today he's out expanding his vast entrepreneurial empire. But he says, you must be the pig at breakfast and not the chicken. He goes on to say, nobody is ever going to care about your business as much as you do. What is he talking about there, Eric Chubb, business coach?
Well, being the pig at breakfast, if you think about it, the chicken's not that invested, right? The chicken's providing some eggs for breakfast, and it doesn't really care if you come take the eggs or not. It's just doing its thing. The pig has to give its life. The pig has to be fully committed and fully invested in breakfast to give you ham and bacon and all those yummy, yummy breakfast accoutrements. So the same mindset has to be towards your business. You got to be the pig. You got to fully commit yourself if you're going to make this thing successful. And just one thing to talk about on this move number one with credit cards. We're working with a guy right now.
Right now.
He's an intern in our office, starting up a new company.
Yep.
He got all his equipment about a month ago, and he's rocking and rolling. He didn't have any funding source, so we had to find him some credit cards, and he's now rocking and rolling. No,
rocking
no payments
and rolling.
For 18 months. And so it's a real move, and he's out there really doing it, 20 years old.
Worked with a realtor about 3 years ago, 4 years ago, who had no money and got denied for some small business loans, couldn't get a home equity line because they had so much of their house in debt. They were able to fund their whole business with $4,500. And I remember her telling me, she goes, I'm investing this in the business, but I only have $4,500 total available. It has to work. And I said, I know. And I remember telling her this notable quotable. Steve Jobs once said, Steve Jobs, the co-founder of Apple and the former CEO of Pixar, he said, he's talking about how to get over the fear of losing it all. He says, remembering that you're going to die is the best way that I know to avoid the trap of thinking you have something to lose. You've got to be all in.
That's kind of heavy, man.
Andy, when you came over here from England to play basketball at Oral Roberts University, do you remember the feeling of going, I'm going across the pond.
Yes.
I'd better be all in. What were you thinking when you decided to move from England, your native country, to America to play basketball at Oral Roberts University?
I was thinking that I love the game, but I'm leaving my family. I'm leaving them at the airport. I'm leaving my two brothers who depend on me behind. And it was a rough feeling. And I better go over here and I better represent them well. And thankfully, I was able to do that. And now they all live over here and my whole family and generations are now here. Ooh. So,
do you remember when you decided to? And by the way, he did. He brought his brothers over here across the pond. It's like an English invasion now. You've got Paul's here, Chris is here, your mom and dad are here.
That's right.
Now, do you remember when you decided to get married? Do you remember that?
I do. I clearly remember that. Yes.
10 minutes. Don't tell us everything you were thinking.
Right.
Just maybe a few things. Clean it up. But I mean, when you're about ready to walk down the aisle, what was going through your cranium? Do you remember that? You're thinking like, were you going, know if this will work out, or were you 100%? What kind of thoughts were you having pre-walking down that aisle?
I was. Before I met the lady of my life, I did not ever think about marriage. And while I'm walking down the aisle, I'm thinking to myself, is this what? Wait a minute. I'm drastically in love. Let's just not think. And I tried to take all thoughts out of my mind, but I knew it was a big life change.
And you committed to it.
Absolutely.
How many years have you guys been married now?
We've been married for 13 years now.
Whoa!
13 glorious years.
And hey,
that's amazing.
And you have 5 kids?
We do. Yeah, we have 5 kids.
Dang!
So are you Amish?
I'm not Amish.
Are you Mormon?
He likes to practice.
We are finished at 5, I must
add. All right, 5.
You're finished at 5, yes.
Okay, so the thing is, you're all in. You committed. Mm-hmm. And if you're gonna have a successful marriage, you've got to commit. You want to have a successful business, you've got to commit. You want to have a non-successful business, don't commit. You want to have a non-successful marriage, don't commit. And we come back, we're going to talk more about how to fund your startup business. And I encourage you, if you want to start a business, go to ThriveTimeShow.com and download the Start Here book for free. It's all the business moves that Dr. Z and I know about how to build a successful company. It's a 550-page book. You can download it for free. Get it today. It's ThriveTimeShow.com. That's the Start Here book. Stay tuned.
Broadcasting live from the center of the universe, it's Business School Without the BS, featuring optometrist turned entrepreneur, Dr. Robert Zoellner, with USSBA Entrepreneur of the Year, Clay Clark.
All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the conversation. It is the Thrive Time Show on your radio. If you are listening to the show for the first time and you're asking yourself, what mistakes have I made? What poor choices have I made to end up here? What am I even listening to? Well, what you're doing is you're listening to a show that we host every day. That's Dr. Zoellner and myself, Clay Clark. We've built 13 multi-million dollar companies between the two of us.
Woo!
And so we thought about saying, what should we do now? And we thought, you know what? Let's do a radio show so we can teach the super moves that we use on a daily basis to get where we are. And I will just to tell you, if you've never started a successful business, you can do it. I took algebra 3 times. I took my ACT 3 times. I'm not that smart. He's an optometrist. He studied mathematics. He is that smart. There's kind of like Batman and Robin. I kind of look at it as it's like kind of like Batman and Beavis. And I'm Beavis. But he's typically here with us. But today he's out expanding his vast entrepreneurial empire. And then we started an online program and now in-person workshops and one-on-one consulting where we can actually teach you how to grow a business. We can actually coach you through the proven path to build a successful business for less money than you would typically spend on hiring even one $10 per hour employee. And we've done it in the auto auction industry, optometry, men's haircuts, photography, videography, carpet cleaning, entertainment companies, banking. There's really no industry we haven't gone into and pretty much dominated. And it's not because we're geniuses. It's because we know the system.
So Clay, can I jump in and
say
something?
Sure, yeah.
I just want to say a message. If you're out there struggling in a business, you can speak to this, Clay. It is so much fun when you have a successful business. When there's money coming in and you're closing deals and you're hiring. It is a lot of fun. So keep grinding. Set your long-term goal. You can get through this hard point. And once you get to that successful spot at the top of the mountain, it is a blast when you're riding down the hill. It's so much fun.
It's awesome. And today we're talking about specifically how to fund your startup business or how to fund your business growth. How do you do it? Well, move number two, family and friends. Am I kidding? No. Sam Walton, Walmart. Jeff Bezos, Amazon, and countless other entrepreneurs have secured funding from people that they know. You see, Sam Walton's father-in-law actually lent him the money to start his first business. And the parents of Jeff Bezos pretty much emptied out their entire retirement fund. These guys invested $300,000 in his business because nobody else wanted to invest in it. And if you 100% believe and your business model and your success, if you believe in it, then you should absolutely consider borrowing money from family and friends. And I recommend borrowing smaller amounts of money from a lot of people, like $10,000 from 10 people, as opposed to $100,000 from just one person. Because typically, one major investor will create problems because they want to dominate each and every move and in each and every business decision that you make. So now you have a partner who's going to kind of control that business. But you say, well, what is it going to ruin the relationship? No, it'll improve the relationship. You realize how many family and friends who've invested in my businesses over the years who I've paid off with interest? All of them. I've never, ever, not one time, ever. And the thing is, some businesses take longer. When I built Party Perfect, it took a long time. But I remember when I paid Stacy Thorne, she got a 20% return on her money, which is better than the market was going to give her.
That's awesome.
But the key is there, you have to pay them back, yeah. People.
Yes.
Don't start a business and borrow money from friends and family if you don't actually intend to start the business.
If you just got one toe in the water. You got to jump all the way.
Yeah. You got to be committed. You got to be the pig at breakfast, as we mentioned earlier. Now, Eric Chupp, I want to read a notable quotable to you, and I want to get your feedback on this, okay? You coach with clients all across the planet as a business coach and a consultant. And this is a notable quotable from George Patton Jr. He was a member of the U.S. Army who was in charge of the U.S. 7th Army and in many of the battles fought in the European regions versus Adolf, not so awesome Hitler. He says, the time to take counsel of your fears is before you make an important battle decision. That's the time to listen to every fear you can imagine. When you've collected all the facts and fears and you've actually made your decision, turn off all of your fears and go ahead. What advice would you have for the entrepreneur listening who actually has done the math, done the research, and now they do owe money to family and friends, and they feel stuck? What advice would you have for them?
Well, what I would pull from that quote is basically one thing. You got to be proactive with your plan. You got to think about your strategy. You got to think with the end in mind when you're doing your plan, right? And then the next thing, like we were just talking about, is a full commitment. You have got to be committed and stop worrying about the things because you know that you were diligent you made a proactive plan. You're going to follow that plan, so you don't need to think about what you're doing now. Just commit to the plan and keep moving forward.
Now, you work with a lot of clients that are very diligent and very consistent, but can you think of one that really just is committed, really diligent, really focused, the kind of client that you're just going, man, I know these guys, these ladies, these people are going to be very successful because of that work ethic?
Yes, actually, a guy that I met with on Thursday morning, his name is Dennis Murphy with A&R Alignment up there on Long Island.
Long Island!
This guy is just on fire, man.
Grinding.
He is grinding. He's learning. He's coachable. He's appreciative. When he has a breakthrough, he is verbal about it, and he's very committed to his cause. He's got a goal for 5 years of what he wants to do with the business and where he wants to go beyond that. And so, you know, on my end, working with him is a pleasure. He pumps me up too. So it's a fun thing.
Pleasure.
You know what's kind of funny is that he actually heard of us through one of the Thrivers from Long Island.
Yes,
Melissa.
Yes.
So check out how marketing works here.
Yes. Woof.
We are top in Google for a lot of different terms, and so Melissa found us while looking for a business coach. So she then reads the reviews and she watches the testimonials, and she did a lot of research. She discovered our program was month to month and there wasn't an obligation. And so she called. I remember talking to her, and she was like, so you mean you guys do all the graphic design, all the photography, all the business coaching, all the planning, yep, all of the advising, all the sales scripting,
yep,
all yep, for yep, less money than I would pay a $10 per hour employee.
Yep, yep, oh, yes, yep, yep.
So
yep,
she books a ticket. She comes out to a workshop. Robert Redmond is her business coach.
It's true. And shout out to Robert. Yo,
big shout out to Robert. And so she starts having a lot of successes up there in Long Island. So then she tells her friends about our Thrivetime Show conference, the two-day workshops that we host every other month, and they fly out. Well, those people learn a lot. They're having success. So then they come back. They bring friends. And now we've got a big group of people from Long I think it's probably 25 people from Long Island.
Were they dancing?
Yes, that was them.
Yes.
Dancing.
Breaking it down.
And then she tells her friend about the success she's having, and that's how you're working with the A&R.
Dennis, he's a good dude.
So Dennis is a referral from a referral from a referral from a conference attender who found us on Google. It all makes sense.
And when you wow your clients, that's what happens.
That's what happens.
Do a good job and deliver, that word of mouth mm-hmm. spreads, and they become apostles. We talk about it, but then they're going out spreading the word.
Mm-hmm. Now, super move number three to finance your existing business, to raise some extra capital, is you could create a premium package. Typically, the top percentage of your customers don't care about the price that you're charging at all. In fact, the most exclusive VIP experiences possible is what they want. In fact, I'll just give you an example. I was working with a fitness-related business recently, and he charges about $150 a month for his service. And he realized that some of the clients were actually willing to pay more money than $150 a month. They actually wanted one-on-one coaching. They wanted one-on-one fitness training. And so he developed a premium package that he was selling for $1,500 a month. Now, his normal package is $150 for a group training. He starts charging $1,500 for one-on-one training, and guess what? His top clients signed up for it. And he was able to get many people to sign up for that package, and that put him in a great
spot
financially. If you are stuck financially, stay tuned. We're going to teach you how to fund or start that successful business on today's show. It's the Thrivetime Show on your radio. Stay tuned.
Broadcasting live. This is Thrivetime for your drive time. Welcome to the Thrivetime Show on Talk Radio 1170.
Oh, yes. Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I'm the former U.S. SBA Entrepreneur of the Year and the father of five sensational human kids, one of which is getting too old. I'm so tired of it. You can't be 13. We talked about this. We said,
And I
went to a performance over there at St. Augustine, and there's a boy talking to my daughter.
No. Get out.
No. And that's, I looked at him with the tiger eye. Yes.
Laser bolts.
And mm-hmm. it didn't work. Mm. So I changed and I looked at him with the rooster eye. And I kind of got that crazy sort of that. And then I gave him like the drunk, angry eye. That didn't work. Yeah. And then I went ahead and pumped my shotgun a couple times. And then all of a sudden he was, no, but it's if you're listening to the show and your kids are out there, turning 13, you know, 14, 12, 4, whatever. You're only going to live once. Rumor has it, right? So you might as well build a successful business and get to financial freedom as soon as possible so you can spend your downtime chasing around your kids, chasing your wife. That's what life's all about.
Preach.
Life is not all about you sitting there all day making checklists and fiddling away doing stuff that doesn't matter.
And
what you want to do is you want to build a successful business as soon as possible. And that's why we do this show, Time Freedom and Financial Freedom, Steve.
Yeah, and I must say, Clay, you have great kids.
Yes.
You know, when you have great, and everybody knows that, right? Mm-hmm, but it's not. But it's worth pointing out, especially your oldest, which you were just talking about, who just started. She was homeschooled, right? For a long time, and it's exciting to see. She's 13 now, and she started to go to school, and then there's the boy thing, because we've talked about it a few times when we're at Thrive. But man, your kids are great. All of them are. They come in and do the trash, sweep the floors, do all the chores around Thrive, and we all really. It's a testament to you and Vanessa just how great your kids are. So,
well, I appreciate you saying that. And Vanessa definitely invests heavy amounts of time in raising the kids. And I, my whole thing I want to teach the kids is a work ethic. And when they clean the office, they get paid for cleaning. And if they don't do it, they don't get paid. So that's how they earn their money.
Wait,
well,
also if they don't, do it, we all give them we give it to them if they don't. We're like, hey,
I
man,
don't do allowances. They have to earn it. It's like a job. And so Aubrey's been saving up his money for about 5 months, and he pulls me aside and he says, Dad, I want the new 15-inch Mackie self-powered speakers. And I said, Son, those are like $400 a piece. And he says, I know, and I want two of them. And I look at him, and I realize this is the same man who bought himself a riding lawnmower with money he saved. Wow. And he's been focused, and so he just bought those speakers. Now his new thing he wants today is he wants a computer that he can play Spotify on so he can DJ. You hook it up with Spotify, and so today is the day we go out there and we get a computer. So he works hard. He's saving up his money. Aubrey, I know you listen to this show often, so look at me. Aubrey, focus. Listen.
Obs.
Listen, do not touch your sisters. Just let them sit in the back, because they're going to say, stop touching me. Don't touch them, and understand that you're in a house of estrogen. You have four sisters, one of you. Just let it happen, and then eventually you'll win the game of life. Let them win the battles. Because eventually you'll win the war. They'll all be working for you someday.
Oh, yes.
Now, super move awesome. Number four. Offer discounts for payment in advance. If you're trying to find a way to fund the business quickly, you can offer discounts if the customers pay you in advance. So if you're trying to generate money to fund your business growth, so you want to change your pricing model so that way you have a package that allows that customer. I'll give you an example. There's a fitness company I've worked with for a long, long time. I actually have done this with many fitness companies. And I'm actually doing this move right now with three fitness companies at the same time. It works. One of them needs to raise about $100,000 this month. The other one needs to raise about $40,000 this month.
Wow.
The other one needs to do about $10,000 this month. It's a super easy move, by the way. And they already do sales at the gym. And so the gym, you charge like, let's say, $50 a month, or for the personal training class, it's $150 a month. And what you do is you tell the person, you say, hey, it's $150 a month, month to month, or if you want to prepay for the year, we'll give you a 50% off discount. You just prepay. And they go, really? And you go, yeah, because he already has a hard cost that's already being met. He already has a certain number of members. His bills are being paid, and he needs to generate the cash needed to open up another location. So, and this happens. It's happening. It happens. It works all the time. And at least I'd say 60% of people say who can do it. They'll say, right. Yeah, I'll go ahead and do that.
Because they're going to keep working out for the next year.
Right.
And they're going to be paying it, whether it's month to month or not, right? And they're like,
So if you do the math on this, Steve, can you bust out your calculator real quick here?
I got it.
Trying to produce a show and
he's
do this calculator.
He's on
so,
it.
So 150 times 6, what does that come down to?
It's like 150 times 6, it's $900.
Yes! Win! Yeah. Winner!
Hey, so, I'm the calculator, Chup.
So he was closing this one guy I'm thinking of in particular. He was closing about 14 new memberships a week and was losing about 3. And he's doing the same thing now, but he's getting most of them to pay that $900. So I think he's generating, I think he told me last week, like $8,000 a week of profit right now extra. And he'll do that until he gets to his $100,000. And then what'll happen is once he hits his goal of $100,000 at his current pace, it'll probably take him, 10 weeks or so to get there. And we're doing more advertising. But once he gets there, then he'll stop doing that deal. And yeah, the consequence, the trade-off, is he doesn't have that long-term revenue coming in after those 6 months, but he's already break-even. And it's a move, and it's a move that's just like printing money. I'm very proud of the client we work with, and he's doing the move, and it works great. Now,
I've got an example real quick as well. So the super diligent guys, Ron and Dustin and Travis over there at Keystone Harbor.
Oh, come on, preach it.
They've got a version of this that it's a little bit different, but it's the same concept. They built some new slips out at their marina, and they want to get those things.
Wait, you said the word slips.
Slips. Okay, that's where
we have a lot of women who are listening to the show who are like, they built slips?
How do you build that?
So we've got these guys that, we got these guys who have a marina.
They're silk.
And what they're doing is they're building slips and lingerie.
That's it.
You know, because they have a marina. You understand the connection, obviously.
A, B, C.
Women go there. They want to make they make underwears. They make slips at the marina. Chef, what are you talking about?
A boat slip. So where you park your boat out on the lake instead of having to...
This whole time I was thinking...
Sick freak.
Something
come
different.
Come on, Steve. Come on. Come on. Okay, so where you park your boat if you don't want to trailer it out to the lake every week, right? So you can get a slip and you can get a lift in that slip to keep your boat in, okay? All right, guys, we're all on the same page now. Everybody's good.
I swear, I don't understand why. It could be the marina / slip emporium. We get you what you need to wear under the dresses, and we also get... I'll give your boat an address.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's
it ties in.
New no-brainer. That's no, a purple cow.
I didn't even use my brain while coming up with the offer.
Long story long. These guys built a new row of slips, and they're really, the boat season is not going to pick up until March, April. So they're going ahead and saying, hey, if you'll pay for the year, we'll start it in April, but we'll go ahead and make that slip year. So pay now. It's your slip until April. Go ahead and get your boat out here. You don't actually start paying until April. So they're paying it forward, and now they've got these things rented out before they're even finished building.
So pay now. Get your butt in there later.
Slip right in right there.
It's welcome to the marina / undergarments emporium. What a bad business idea.
Steve is in the corner. He's literally over in the corner.
Right now, super move number 5, raising your prices. We come back, we're going to talk about how to generate the cash you need to fund your business. And one of the ways to do it, my friends, my foes, my enemies, my frenemies, my neighbors, my cousins, my exiled family, the family that I still embrace, the people I know, who I don't know, ladies, men, transgenders.
Holla!
When we come back, we're going to talk about raising prices. And if you are transgendered, nobody knows how to raise prices more in a way that relates to the transgender community than Steve Currington with Total Lending Concepts. If you're looking for a men's restroom or a women's restroom, if you're tired of the tyranny of having to choose, if you go into Total Lending Concepts, don't you have all three bathrooms?
Universal. We do the what do they call it? Gender neutral.
The family bathroom.
There's no doors. It's just wide open toilets.
Stay tuned. It's the Thrive Time Show.
It's gender neutral.
On your radio. The most gender neutral show on the AM.
And now, broadcasting from the center of the universe and the Thrive15.com world headquarters, it's the Thrive Time Show.
If you want to be the man or you want to be the woman, if you want to be successful, if you want to make your life a little bit stressful, then you have found the show that's all about you. All we do is talk about helping you. That's all we want to do. And we're teaching you today specifically how to raise the capital that your business needs to grow, whether it's a startup or an existing company. If you need capital, capital is the fuel that you need to grow that business. It's the fuel your vehicle needs. You've got to come up with the capital. And super move number 5 is you might want to look into raising your prices.
Oh, raise them up.
5%. Now, I want to explain. I want to get a little bit deeper
people
than what.
People are so scared to do this.
Well, I want to get a little bit deeper than what people are.
He's got a shovel. He's got a shovel out.
Well, though, this is where it gets deep. Okay, so what happened was, and there's a thing called the Gold Standard Act. Okay, so what happened is the United States, our currency, basically has always been backed by gold. Okay, and so what happens is there was a way to guarantee the value of our money. So the government prints dollars. They print it out of a printer. And then they say a dollar is worth a dollar because we have gold in the bank that's equal to the amount of dollars we're printing. Well, in 1971, Richard Nixon, he's trying to balance the budget. You ever tried to balance the budget when you don't have enough money? You know, you're out of money, you're running out of cash, you're sitting around the kitchen table going, I don't know what I'm going to do. I mean, I don't know how we're going to do it. I don't know. And you're trying to find a way to come up with extra money. And then he realizes, I'm the man. He's like, I really. And the guy next to him goes,
you are the man.
Sir, you are the man. And he's like, I am the man. And he's like, He said, they said, Richard, you're the man. He says, I'm so tired of the man. And they said, Richard, you are the man. He says, you're right. So I am in charge. Oh man, this is awesome. Typically, man, when you're bouncing your checkbook, you know, guys, we typically, and Richard's talking to his team, they're all gathered around, they're like, this is the president, man, he's getting deep. But he says, guys, typically, when you have to balance your budget, you have to spend less money than you bring in, and that's how it works. And they're like, yeah, you're a genius, boss. Right, absolutely. Ooh, and he says, here's the deal, Trevor. There's a guy named Trevor in the room, probably a guy named Carl, a lot of names from the 70s, you know. And Carl says, well, sir, what do you want to do? And he goes, what we're going to do, man, is I'm going to go down to Office Depot. I got this new printer. I know it's an Epson. It's a laser, you know. It's inkjet, okay. Well, anyway, the point is it doesn't bleed too much. But we're going to just start printing money. And they're like, sir, I know you're the man, but that seems kind of ludicrous. And he's like, no. We're going to call it. We're going to give it a name so it's not going to freak people out. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and take us off of the gold standard. And I'm going to call it, you know, in 1971, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to call it the Gold Standard Act. I'm going to kind of move some stuff around. The point is, it's for the betterment of America. And so I'm going to just start printing money. And they go, sir, so you mean you're going to be able to pour as much water in the Kool-Aid as possible? And then some smart guy in the room, probably a Billy or a Mac, some guy from the 70s. Billy,
mustachioed.
Yeah, there's no women in the room. And they're all smoking, by the way. They're all like,
Chain smoking.
It's a great idea, boss. It's a great idea. So he says, hey, could you stop smoking and pay attention? He says, all right. So he says, here's the deal, Burns, what I want you to do is I want you to keep pouring the water into the Kool-Aid. And I want you to keep printing that money. And then Burns says, but sir, if we put enough water in the Kool-Aid, eventually it'll taste like water. You know, it'll have no value to it. It'll be diluted, you know. And if we do the same thing with the money, I wouldn't even want the money, you know. And he's like, Burns, you're fired. And then Carl says, but I agree, sir. You're the man. You want me to smoke? Not smoke? Yep, sir. No. So that's what happened. In 1971, we just quit using the gold standard. And now we can just print money and there's no value to our dollars at all other than the faith of the American people. So here's what I'm getting at. Every year, your dollar is worth 3% less than last year. So as an example, Steve, if I want you to guess here, quiz show, okay? Steve, you can guess. Chup, you can guess. If you were to buy a truck today for $40,000, okay? So if a truck, a brand new truck today costs $40,000, okay?
$40,000.
How much, let's just say that you bought a truck, and I'm going to pull up my inflation calculator here, okay? And by the way, for all the Thrivers, if you're looking for a good time, you can always pull up the inflation calculator.
That's like a roller coaster ride. It's
so let's say that I bought a truck for $4,000 in 1971. It was $4,000, brand new truck, 1971, okay? How much would that same truck cost in today's dollars? January 1971 and then today's dollars. If I bought it for $4,000, it was a less expensive model.
What year would it have been?
1971. How much would it be today?
$48,000.
Steve?
He's on an inflation calculator.
I am not. I'm just looking on.
Come on.
I'm just trying to guess.
You cheater.
Just give
Sandbagger.
Me a second.
He's on Facebook.
I'm just trying to find out.
I don't know if you're aware. This is a radio show. And it's not super visually exciting to watch somebody type things into a
is it maybe $14,454.99?
$24,805.
Oh, I did something wrong.
Now, real quick. Now, the inflation rate, by the way, is typically higher than 3%. It just is. The lowest it is right now is about 3%. Now, what happens is then let's say you bought a nice truck and for $8,000 back in 1971. How much would it cost now for the nice
$48,000.
Truck? $48,000.
$49,611. Oh, I was close.
So that means that your
price is right. I'm crushing it
there. That means that your money is losing that much value every year. You've got to raise your prices by 5% a year. You have to. At least 3% raise those prices. You might
get
say,
crazy and make it 6.
Now, here's what I do. And some people say, well, that you're hypocritical. You don't do that for some of your companies. Here's what I do. Whenever I start a business, I start out and I want to be the most affordable business in the market. I want to be the lowest price, and I work very hard for the first 3 to 5 years of a company to make it more efficient and to cost less and less and less. Our Thrive Business Coaching Program, I used to have to charge $3,000 a month minimum to coach businesses. Now we have it down where our packages can start, and we have all different levels, all different options, but they can start as low as $1,500. I'm working on a package here, Chep, where soon people will be able to start for as little as $1,000 consistently.
That's like a $7 an hour employee.
It's unbelievable.
$6.
But we're doing it because I am getting more and more efficient. Our team's getting more efficient. You're making suggestions. John Kelly's making suggestions. Andy's making suggestions. Kat's making suggestions. And the cumulative team mind is working on making it more affordable than ever. Now, once we get to the lowest possible, we always want to operate at a 25 to 30% profit.
Right.
But once we get it to where we can operate at a 25% profit at $1,000 a month, then we'll start consistently raising prices 3%. We always want to make it the most affordable. Now, for Elephant in the Room, it is a premium service, which means we have to charge premium prices based upon the fact that we really go out of our way to offer a very high-end experience, and it costs a lot of money to do that. So every business is a little bit different, but you cannot be afraid of raising prices.
That's one thing that I've heard you talk about a lot, and it's really stuck with me in the past, Clay, is that the fear mentality versus the abundance mentality. And if you're freaking out about raising your prices a little bit, that's a fear-based mentality. So you got to change that thinking and get more into that abundance
mindset. How did you hear about this job, Thrive?
Craigslist.
Did you?
Yeah.
Whoa.
So here's the thing is, I this is just an example. With our companies, we do an interview every week on a Tuesday. You've been working with us for about two years.
Yeah.
And, you know, John's been with us for like almost five.
Yeah.
And John actually came to us because his friend found us on Craigslist, and then he was referred. And I have an abundance mentality towards friendships and towards business and towards everything except for my wife. With my wife, it's a scarcity thing. Let me give you an example. If I have a friend who is disrespectful to my wife, which has happened, or to me, I will call him on it and say, hey, I didn't appreciate that. I'm not perfect, but I need you to stop whatever that is. You know.
Right.
And if the person doesn't, I have been known to say things such as, we're done speaking.
Adios, muchacho.
And you're like, to your friend that you've known since school, like high school, like college? Like, yep. And why? It's because of an abundance mentality. And that's why I have time in my schedule to develop a relationship with Dr. Zoellner. That's why I had time to meet a guy like Sean Copeland. That's why I have a chance to meet a guy like Lee Cockrell or David Robinson or Michael Levine. It's because I'm saying no to certain people. Now, the reason why I can develop a relationship with Eric Chupp is because I am no longer hanging around with idiots. It's like pruning a tree. And I don't get emotional about it. The people that I had to fire made room for Chupp. There was somebody I had to fire, and then I think it was on the video side. Mm-hmm. I had to fire a guy for not performing, and it made room for you. But if you don't do intentional tree pruning, you're not going to have room. And when it comes to raising your prices, you can't feel like there's a limited number of customers out there and that you're just eking out to fight for the very last one of them.
Right.
Have an abundance mentality. Super move number six. Lease instead of buy. When I first bought my first phone system for DJ Connection, that phone system was $70,000.
Dang.
Steve, do you remember when phone systems were 70
yes.
grand? Yes.
I mean,
so I'm telling you what, if you are trying to kind of, you know, produce a little lightning before the thunder, so to speak, you're trying to financially figure out how to fund your business, stay tuned. That's what we're talking about today on the Thrivetime Show.
Just a young gun with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold, have a seat in the foyer. Take a number. I was lightning before the thunder.